this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us cope in this world.
God said,
oh.
for the God above all.
Of all other gods.
Say with every name of the
people of God, we have met on this special day to hear the word of God, to hear him speak to us. And today is special because today is what we call Palm Sunday. And when we were children, this will be the day on which we know that mommy will prepare our favorite fufu and palm nut soup. But we want to thank God that now the day is more, means something more to us than just eating fufu and palm nut soup. But if you have fufu and palm nut soup, you are free to go ahead. But we pray that the importance of this day will not be lost on you. And on this Palm Sunday, or the day of the triumphant entry, I have chosen a passage from Luke chapter 19, from verse 37 until verse 44, or maybe I'll even read to 48. So Luke chapter 19, 37 to 48, but it's a long story, but I think it's important for us to be able to follow the events of the day as written in the Bible. Luke 19, 37 to 48. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, "If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace. But now, they are things hidden from your eyes. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you and hem you in on every side. They will crush you to the ground, you and your children within you. And they will not leave within you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation. Because you did not recognize the time of your visitation from God. Then he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling. And he said, "It is written, my house shall be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers." Every day he was teaching in the temple. The chief priests, the scribes, and the leaders of the people kept looking for a way to kill him. But they did not find anything they could do, for all the people were spellbound by what they heard. Amen. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for today. It is the day of your triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And since you entered Jerusalem triumphantly, we know that you are also able to speak triumphantly into whatever situation that confronts us. As we listen to your word, there are situations that confront us as individuals. There are situations that confront us as a nation. There are situations that we face as families. Father, may your triumphant entry into Jerusalem mark a turning point for everyone, especially as we deal with the COVID-19 situation. There is nothing that is beyond you. So as you ride triumphantly into Jerusalem, may you ride triumphantly into our problems. As we speak your word, as we listen to your word, let your spirit take your word and minister that word to us at the point of need. And we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Friends, as I said, today is what we call Palm Sunday. It begins what as Christians we refer to as the Holy Week. Now, don't get me wrong, every day that God has created is holy, and every week that God has created is holy, and every month and every year that God creates is holy. We only call this week Holy Week because it is the last week in which the events that led to the crucifixion, the arrest, the suffering, the humiliation, crucifixion, and the resurrection of Jesus is celebrated. This is the day. The Palm Sunday begins that week. So that's why we call it the Holy Week. It's a week in which we focus very much on the cross of Christ, because the cross of Christ is at the very heart of our faith. In fact, if you take the cross out of our Christianity, we'll be left with nothing. And so we call it the Holy Week because it is the week in which we focus very directly on the cross and the eventual resurrection of Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the final week that Jesus physically spends on earth, and the triumphant entry begins with the ride, the victorious ride into Jerusalem. Now, quite a number of things happen during the day of the triumphant entry. And as I said, when we were children, this was simply called Palm Sunday or Hosanna Day, if you like. And the main event of the day began when Jesus sent two of his disciples to fetch for him a donkey. You would find that in Luke chapter 19 from verse 29 to 30. Jesus sends the two of the disciples. They had on their rounds, they had stopped at a place called Bethphage in Bethany. And it was from that location that Jesus sent two of the disciples to go and fetch a donkey for him from the city. And he told them that if anybody questioned them as to what they were going to do with the donkey, they should just simply say the Lord needs it. Whether Jesus had made prior arrangements or whether he knew the owner, the Bible does not say. And I don't like to read into the Bible what it does not say. All we know is that Jesus sent two of his disciples to go and fetch the donkey, and he told them what to say if the owner should ask them why they were fetching the donkey, and that's exactly what happened. So the disciples brought the donkey, and we are told in the text that they threw some linen on the animal. Jesus sat on it and began to enter Jerusalem. When you read the accounts from Mark, you know that Jesus was very clear in his mind what was going to happen to him in Jerusalem. He knew that he was riding into enemy territory. And this is not a matter that he had hidden from his disciples. So even Peter tried to stop him. And Jesus said to him, "Get thee behind me, Satan." Because by stopping him, Peter was becoming a stumbling block to the purposes of God for his life. If you know the purposes of God for your life, you don't allow anyone to stop you from God's purposes. Because ultimately, God's purposes will end in victory, as we see in the life of Jesus when God's purposes ended in the resurrection. Amen. We are told that the disciples and the crowd began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice. And they praised God because they had seen the deeds of power. That is what the Bible says. They had seen the deeds of power that Jesus had performed. In Luke chapter 19, verse 37. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power they had seen. We learned in our previous message that there are people who will refuse to see anything good in your life. But don't mind them. Don't mind them. When God is doing something good in another person's life, it's always a sign of maturity, and in fact a sign of humility for you to rejoice in them. The Pharisees were unhappy that Jesus healed a man born blind, and they would not be happy that there were crowds around Jesus celebrating him for the deeds of power. The blind had had their eyes restored. The crippled had walked. The hungry had been fed. The dead had been brought back to life. And these were deeds of power that had to be celebrated. And so the crowds were celebrating. How were they celebrating? They were hailing Jesus as king. Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And we are told in other versions of scripture that people had gone into the bushes nearby. They had fetched palm branches. And in the Bible, palm branches were a sign of victory. And we find it even in the book of Revelation, when the saints around the throne of the Lamb take palm branches in their hands and they wave and celebrate God, celebrate his holiness, celebrate his victories. And we pray that God will give us reason to celebrate our victory over coronavirus, over anything that is keeping us down. And then we shall bless him and say, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." If you believe that, say amen. Unfortunately, in the midst of these celebrations, there were people who never wanted to see the great things of God. In Luke chapter 19, the passage we have read, verses 39 to verse 40, the Pharisees begin to protest the celebration of Jesus. They had decided that they would never appreciate anything good in the life of Jesus. So even when people were praising him, and remember that those who were following Jesus were likely to include those he had healed, those he had fed, those he had blessed. You can't stop such people from praising Jesus. They decided to protest. But the crowds were adamant. They were adamant. And Jesus told the Pharisees, even if these people shut up, remember that God in his sovereignty and his supremacy is able to raise stones to celebrate my mighty acts. Oh, what a statement. You have to know that if God is at work, you cannot stop him. So those of us who oppose the work of God in the lives of other people, know that you are wasting your time. For some time, it may be that you are winning. But in the end, God will always have the last word. He had the last word in the life of the man born blind. And he's going to have the last word in the lives of those people who please him. And God had the last word when he raised Jesus from the dead. So Jesus told them, even if the crowds shut up, stones, praise will come from an unexpected quarter. So you are wasting your time in trying to oppose God. A lot of lessons can be learned from the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. But one that is striking for me is how in the midst of the celebration, people seemed happy that Jesus was going to Jerusalem because in their minds, Jesus was going to overthrow the imperial kingdom of Rome. A new king was going to be established. So they were happy. And of course, they had every right to be happy. But something was happening in the life of Jesus. Mature people are people who have discernment. And one of the lessons that we learn from the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem is that God teaches us that we must have a spirit of discernment. Because the triumphant entry in Jerusalem was not all about celebrating what Jesus had done in the past. It was about what lay ahead of him, the reason for which he came. Some of those following him had not come to a realization that the coming of Jesus was more about the salvation of God in Christ. And that is what Jesus wanted to draw attention to. So in Luke chapter 19, verse 41, this is what we read. As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it. As he came near and saw the city, in the midst of the euphoria, in the midst of the rejoicing, in the midst of the happiness, Jesus wept. And these were not tears of joy. These were tears of sympathy. These were tears that Jesus shed because the people around him hadn't realized the purpose for which he was entering Jerusalem. In fact, that's why Peter tried to stop him. What was the cry of Jesus? And the cry of Jesus is written for us in Luke 19, 42 to 44. If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. You don't have discernment. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you and hem you on every side. The people had not realized the calamity that was coming. in the midst of the rejoicing, in the midst of the celebration, they had become oblivious to the things that Jesus had warned them about. It's like this virus that is upon us. We were going about our world, our work, as if everything about this world is straightforward. We're going about our business as if God did not matter. We're going about our business as if wealth, money, property is everything. And then something hits us, and powerful nations are on their knees. That's why Jesus wept. He wept because we have taken God for granted. He wept because our religion is insincere. He wept because we think that we can buy God's grace with money. He wept because we think that Christianity is all about prophesying prosperity and so on. Jesus wept as he came near the city. This was his cry. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you and hem you in on every side. They will crush you to the ground and your children within you, and they will not leave within you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation. If we don't recognize the time of our visitation, things will take us by surprise. And I think nobody is happy that this problem has come upon the world. But God is teaching us that if we don't take care, certain things can take us by surprise. It has taken many people by surprise. Jesus said, you did not recognize the time of your visitation. And that's why he wept. Luke 19:41. As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it. Jesus shed tears. So the entry into Jerusalem was not simply about celebrating a miracle worker. It was not just about going on a procession with palm branches. It was not just about overthrowing the Roman emperor and establishing another earthly revolution. It was about something more profound. The triumphant entry was about something more profound. It grieved the Lord that the people, especially the religious authorities, had not recognized the visitation of God in Christ. And so they opposed him. And so we go to church and yet live our lives anyhow. And we think that our money can open every door. Yes, God wants us to give. But please be aware that we cannot buy his grace by our money and resources. We may be mighty, we may have military might, we may have political power, we may have business power, we may have financial power, but the worship of God takes more than that. It takes a people who have genuinely repented, and that's what Jesus wept about. People were saying, Lord, Lord, when their hearts were far away from him. In short, there was the lack of discernment on the part of the people. People had taken everything for granted, just as we too have taken things for granted. When in fact, God was trying to draw their attention to the fact that terrible times lay ahead. The situation had caught every one of us unprepared. My dear friends, people of God, there is the need to be sober and cry unto God for repentance. Jesus wept over Jerusalem because a lot of what was going on in the name of religion was superficial. It wasn't genuine. And we have all been exposed that much of our Christianity seems to be superficial. Much of what has come to us in the name of the prophetic seems to be superficial. The prophets have been telling us what we want to hear. Jesus wants to tell the people what they have to hear. And that's what he has done in this passage. In a sense, you could say that our Christianity has become like that. Not genuine. Genuine worship is always expressed in heartfelt repentance. The prophet Joel provides a definition of what I'm referring to as heartfelt repentance in the following message to God's people. Joel chapter 2 verse 13. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your heart and not your garments. And that's very critical. Rend your heart and not your garment. Don't just tear your clothes apart to show me that you have repented. But let repentance be repentance of the heart. Rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God. For he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. And he relents from sending calamity. Oh, as we rend our hearts and not our garments, may the Lord of heaven relent from sending calamity upon his people. To rend your heart and not your garments is to show genuine repentance. And that's what Jesus wanted. That's why in the triumphant entry into Jerusalem, as people were celebrating, Jesus was crying, weeping over Jerusalem. The traditional practice in Israel was to express repentance by some symbolic or physical act. This included tearing up one's clothes or smearing oneself in dust and ashes to indicate your mortality and therefore sinful nature. The prophet Joel knew that it was not every such physical act that indicated genuine inward repentance. Some of these acts of repentance were superficial. But Jesus wants heartfelt repentance. That is what prophet Joel called for. Rend your hearts and not your garments. And that is why Jesus weeps. Even today, that is why he weeps. Because a lot of what we are doing in the name of Christianity is superficial in his sight. An important role played by the Holy Spirit in our life is to bring us to points of repentance when we have drifted from our source of being, God himself. So, Jesus told his disciples in John chapter 16, 7 to 8. This is what Jesus says. But I tell you the truth, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. In verses 9 of that same passage, John chapter 16, in regard to sin, in Romans, with regard to sin, because men do not believe in me, in regard to righteousness, because I'm going to the Father. He makes the same point in Romans. But here in John, this is what Jesus says. In other words, by being a source of conviction, the Holy Spirit provides us with God's standard of righteousness. My friends, what we need at this time is conviction of sin that comes from the Spirit. Other people will tell you what you want to hear. But for a person maturing in Christ, what God wants you to hear by the presence of his Spirit must be paramount. God's standard of righteousness is something that human effort cannot attain. We'll do our part in dealing with the problem with science and pharmaceutical products and things like that. But we need to make room for what God wants to do. What God wants to do comes through an outpouring of grief on our fallen nature and gives us the opportunity to purify our hearts. That's what Peter told the people who had come to listen to him on the day of Pentecost. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins. And you will receive the gift of the Spirit. For the promise is for you and for those who are afar off. Jesus wept over Jerusalem because repentance is a turning point. Repentance is always a turning point. It happened in the life of the young man, the prodigal son, who went away from home and squandered the property of his father. When he came unto himself, he said, I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men. And the Bible says, so he got up and he went to his father. That's what we must do. Having heard the word of Jesus, having heard his reprimand, we must get up and we must walk towards the Father who never takes his eyes upon us. It happened to David too. When he was confronted with his sin, with the wife of Uriah, Bathsheba, and Nathan confronted him with a situation, David prayed in Psalm 51, 10 to 12, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. So, it is a genuine attempt to move on from where the Spirit of God has arrested us. That's why Jesus wept over Jerusalem. He wanted them to come to terms with the fact that they had missed the point. The point of why he came was the cross on which he was going to die. Dear friends, this is a time of discernment. God is calling us into discernment as we make frantic efforts in search of solutions to the coronavirus disease. We need to reflect on the things that we have overlooked. That is, the politicization of our lives, the superficiality of our Christianity, our lack of prioritization, and those things that alienate us from the love of God. We have taken the love of God for granted. And God wants us to return. Lamentations chapter 3 verse 40. Let us test and examine our ways and return to the Lord. Jesus Christ weeps over this country. Jesus Christ weeps over our lives because we have squandered opportunities, but there is hope for our future, says Jeremiah. We pray that as we celebrate Hosanna Day, Palm Sunday, the triumphant entry, it will offer us the opportunity to go before the Lord in genuine prayer. And I am confident that he will listen and bring us a restoration. May God bring restoration to your personal life. May he bring restoration to your family. May he bring restoration to our nation. And may he bring restoration to the world. Father, we thank you for your word to us. You are the one who knows where we are hurting. You are the one who knows where we have gotten it all wrong. I pray for the spirit of discernment, that where we have fallen down, you will lift us up. Lord, we pray that he will intervene in this situation and bring healing and restoration to your people. May your name be praised. May your name be glorified. And may your tears over our lives never be in vain. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.